his chiefs of staff. The area he was responsible for was vast and included British land forces in Egypt, the Sudan and Palestine Jordan, East Africa and British Somaliland, as well as any forces that might be dispatched to Turkey, the Balkans, Iraq, Aden or the Persian Gulf. After the fall of France, Wavell's command was the only one fighting a land war against the Axis powers. In early 1941, he was fighting three separate campaigns with limited resources: the Western Desert, the Balkan and East African campaigns, the success of each being determined by events in the Mediterranean. Admiral A.B.C. Cunningham was commander-in-chief of the British Mediterranean Fleet on the outbreak of war in September 1939. Cunningham was the image of a fighting admiral, with piercing blue eyes, ruddy complexion, and an infallible memory for former shipmates. During the worst days of the battle for Crete, one of his staff remarked that fighting the Luftwaffe was like butting one's head against a wall. Cunningham replied that, "What you have forgotten, you miserable undertaker, is that you may be loosening a brick." Cunningham's determination to maintain British naval supremacy was the crucial factor in winning the battle for the Mediterranean. He was prepared to take the battle to the enemy if it would defeat the Axis. His air attack on the Italian fleet in Taranto in November 1940 was a masterstroke, and he always sought to bring the more powerful Italian fleet to battle, and did so with success, notably at Cape Matapan. After a period in Washington, Cunningham returned to the Mediterranean, where he was appointed Allied Naval Commander Expeditionary Force for the Anglo-American Torch landings in November 1942. He was Commander-in-Chief of the Mediterranean, an Allied Naval Commander for the Sicilian Campaign in July 1943 and the Salerno landings in September 1943. Air Marshal Arthur Longmore became the scapegoat for the lack of RAF resources in the Mediterranean, and in May 1941, his deputy, Air Marshal Arthur Tedder, replaced him. Both men recognised the need to sustain the air resources of Malta, as well as improving army air and maritime cooperation. However, after his arrival in July 1942, it was Air Vice Marshal Keith Park who revolutionised the tactical battle fought over Malta. It was he who was able to capitalise on the increased air resources to win the air war and increase Malta's strike effectiveness during the critical battles on the Alamein Line from July to November 1942. The small island of Malta, with a civilian population of 270,000, three airfields, and the port of Valletta, was the only British harbour between Gibraltar and Alexandria. It is 60 miles from Sicily and 1,000 miles from the nearest British base at Gibraltar. It was vulnerable to attack and difficult to supply, but its position made it an important base for attacks by both air and sea on Axis shipping supplying forces in North Africa. Italian aircraft first attacked Malta on the 11th of June 1940. The attacking bombers, flying in formation above the island, faced three obsolete Gloster Gladiator biplanes, aptly named Faith, Hope and Charity, as the island's only air defence. Malta also lacked the means to attack, and in these opening months, Malta was unable to interfere with the supply and reinforcement convoys sailing from Italy to North Africa. In 1940, Malta had six of the seven infantry battalions assessed as necessary for its defence against invasion, but lacked anti-aircraft and air defences. On a rocky island smaller than the Isle of Wight, bisected by ravines and gullies with limited flat land, the three available airfields had a capacity of five squadrons. Two of these were reconnaissance, one of Wellington bombers, and the last Swordfish torpedo bombers. A Hurricane fighter squadron reinforced the original biplanes, and a steady stream of Hurricanes was deployed to Malta as they became available. The island was only 20 minutes flying time from enemy airfields on Sicily, and there was no room on the island to give any depth to the defences. It lacked both an efficient radar and observer system, and so the fighter defences had to be scrambled once the enemy were over the island. The initial vacuum left by the French in the Western Mediterranean, and the fact that Malta lacked initially the ability to interfere with Italian convoys, had allowed Mussolini to reinforce his armies in Libya and Cyrenaica. Spurred on by Mussolini's dream of riding in triumph on a white charger into Cairo, an Italian offensive was launched against Egypt. The Italian forces attacked first under Marshal Balbo and then under Marshal Graziani on the 13th of September 1940. This and the Italian attack on Greece in October 1940 dictated the first major steps in Churchill's war after the fall of France. The Italian offensive into Egypt was a cautious affair. Graziani's 10th Army advanced some 62 miles, with his infantry supported by 72 Italian-designed M11 tanks, which are generally regarded as one of the worst tanks of the Second World War, and inferior in speed, armour and armament to their British cruiser tank opponent. After occupying a line of forts, Graziani halted on the defensive. His army of 250,000 faced a British and Commonwealth force of only 36,000. A similar offensive was launched from Italian East Africa, where the Duke of Aosta invaded Sudan and Kenya and captured British Somaliland with a force of 91,000 Italian troops, backed by 200,000 Abyssinian troops and 352 obsolescent aircraft of the Italian Air Force. Mussolini followed up these offensives with an invasion of Greece from occupied Albania. Britain immediately supported the Greek forces with five RAF bomber squadrons under the 1939 Anglo-French agreement that had guaranteed Greek independence. The bombers assisted the Greeks in their spirited resistance to the Italian army, which, although impressive on paper, lacked the supplies, ammunition, and will to match the outnumbered and ill-equipped Greek army, and the Italian offensive collapsed. The Greeks counterattacked in November 1940, driving the Italians back into Albania. And it seemed that for a while the Italians would lose control of the Adriatic ports that were critical to the resupply of their armies in Albania. It was a humiliating defeat by a partially trained, ill-equipped Greek army that emboldened Churchill to offer support. The Greek success was matched by Cunningham's willingness to take the war at sea to the Italians, and ships of the Mediterranean fleet conducted night bombardments of the Italian-held Adriatic ports. He also planned to mount a torpedo bomber attack on the Italian naval base in Taranto. Cunningham knew that all of the important eggs, namely six Italian battleships, were in one basket in the Italian Navy's main base. At 8:35 p.m. on the 11th of November 1940, the first wave of 12 string bags, as the swordfish were known, were deployed from the deck of the Illustrious, led by Lieutenant Commander Kenneth Williamson of No. 815 Squadron Fleet Air Arm. An hour later, nine string bags of No. 819 Squadron, led by Lieutenant Commander J.W. Hale, followed them. Before dusk, Cunningham had signalled Illustrious as she sailed with her escorts to take up station for the raid 180 miles south of Taranto. It was on the shoulders of this small group of 42 naval airmen in their obsolete aircraft that the course of the war in the Mediterranean rested. The aircraft that droned into the night towards the Italian mainland carried a mix of torpedoes, while others carried flares and bombs. The bombs were to be used on the cruisers and destroyers, and so divert the attention of the Italian anti-aircraft defences, while the magnesium flares would illuminate the battleships for the torpedo attack. The Maryland reconnaissance aircraft from Malta had plotted the location of the barrage balloons protecting the harbour. However, the slow, lumbering swordfish would have to face the combined firepower of six battleships, nine cruisers, and a large number of destroyers, as well as some 21 batteries of heavy anti-aircraft guns, and some 200 close-range automatic weapons guided on by harbour searchlights. The string bags flew into a storm of fire, but dipped and weaved their way towards the illuminated targets. Two were shot down, but as the last aircraft flew out of the barrage of anti-aircraft fire, three Italian battleships were leaking oil into the harbour. The new battleship Littorio had suffered three torpedo hits, and the Duilio had been hit once. They would be out of action for 5 to 6 months. on the island to give any depth to the defences. It lacked both an efficient radar and observer system, and so the fighter defences had to be scrambled once the enemy were over the island. The initial vacuum left by the French in the Western Mediterranean, and the fact that Malta lacked initially the ability to interfere with Italian convoys, had allowed Mussolini to reinforce his armies in Libya and Cyrenaica. Spurred on by Mussolini's dream of riding in triumph on a white charger into Cairo, an Italian offensive was launched against Egypt. The Italian forces attacked first under Marshal Balbo, and then under Marshal Graziani, on the 13th of September 1940. This and the Italian attack on Greece in October 1940 dictated the first major steps in Churchill's war after the fall of France. The Italian offensive into Egypt was a cautious affair. Graziani's 10th Army advanced some 62 miles, with his infantry supported by 72 Italian-designed M11 tanks, which are generally regarded as one of the worst tanks of the Second World War, and inferior in speed, armour and armament to their British cruiser tank opponent. After occupying a line of forts, Graziani halted on the defensive, and the port of Valletta was the only British harbour between Gibraltar and Alexandria. It is 60 miles from Sicily, and 1,000 miles from the nearest British base at Gibraltar. It was vulnerable to attack and difficult to supply, but its position made it an important base for attacks by both air and sea on Axis shipping supplying forces in North Africa. Italian aircraft first attacked Malta on the 11th of June 1940. The attacking bombers, flying in formation above the island, faced three obsolete Gloster Gladiator biplanes, aptly named Faith, Hope and Charity, as the island's only air defence. Malta also lacked the means to attack, and in these opening months, Malta was unable to interfere with the supply and reinforcement convoys sailing from Italy to North Africa. In 1940, Malta had 6 of the 7 infantry battalions assessed as necessary for its defence against invasion, but lacked anti-aircraft and air defences. On a rocky island smaller than the Isle of Wight, bisected by ravines and gullies with limited flat land, the 3 available airfields had a capacity of 5 squadrons. 2 of these were reconnaissance, 1 of Wellington bombers, and the last Swordfish torpedo bombers. A Hurricane fighter squadron reinforced the original biplanes, and a steady stream of Hurricanes was deployed to Malta as they became available. The island was only 20 minutes flying time from enemy airfields on Sicily, and there was no room for the more powerful Italian fleet to battle, and did so with success, notably at Cape Matapan. After a period in Washington, Cunningham returned to the Mediterranean, where he was appointed Allied Naval Commander Expeditionary Force for the Anglo-American Torch Landings in November 1942. He was Commander-in-Chief of the Mediterranean, an Allied Naval Commander for the Sicilian Campaign in July 1943, and the Salerno Landings in September 1943. Air Marshal Arthur Longmore became the scapegoat for the lack of RAF resources in the Mediterranean, and in May 1941, his deputy, Air Marshal Arthur Tedder, replaced him. Both men recognised the need to sustain the air resources of Malta, as well as improving army air and air and maritime cooperation. However, after his arrival in July 1942, it was Air Vice Marshal Keith Park who revolutionised the tactical battle fought over Malta. It was he who was able to capitalise on the increased air resources to win the air war and increase Malta's strike effectiveness during the critical battles on the Alamein Line from July to November 1942. The small island of Malta, with a civilian population of 270,000, 3 airfields, his chiefs of staff. The area he was responsible for was vast, and included British land forces in Egypt, the Sudan and Palestine Jordan, East Africa and British Somaliland, as well as any forces that might be dispatched to Turkey, the Balkans, Iraq, Aden or the Persian Gulf. After the fall of France, Wavell's command was the only one fighting a land war against the Axis powers. In early 1941, he was fighting three separate campaigns with limited resources: the Western Desert, the Balkan and East African campaigns, the success of each being determined by events in the Mediterranean. Admiral A.B.C. Cunningham was Commander-in-Chief of the British Mediterranean Fleet on the outbreak of war in September 1939. Cunningham was the image of a fighting admiral, with piercing blue eyes, ruddy complexion, and an infallible memory for former shipmates. During the worst days of the battle for Crete, one of his staff remarked that fighting the Luftwaffe was like butting one's head against a wall. Cunningham replied that, "What you have forgotten, you miserable undertaker, is that you may be loosening a brick." Cunningham's determination to maintain British naval supremacy was the crucial factor in winning the battle for the Mediterranean. He was prepared to take the battle to the enemy if it would defeat the Axis. His air attack on the Italian fleet in Taranto in November 1940 was a masterstroke, and he always sought to bring his army of 250,000 faced a British and Commonwealth force of only 36,000. A similar offensive was launched from Italian East Africa, where the Duke of Aosta invaded Sudan and Kenya and captured British Somaliland with a force of 91,000 Italian troops, backed by 200,000 Abyssinian troops and 352 obsolescent aircraft of the Italian Air Force. Mussolini followed up these offensives with an invasion of Greece from occupied Albania. Britain immediately supported the Greek forces with five RAF bomber squadrons under the 1939 Anglo-French agreement that had guaranteed Greek independence. The bombers assisted the Greeks in their spirited resistance to the Italian army, which, although impressive on paper, lacked the supplies, ammunition, and will to match the outnumbered and ill-equipped Greek army, and the Italian offensive collapsed. The Greeks counterattacked in November 1940, driving the Italians back into Albania, and it seemed that for a while the Italians would lose control of the Adriatic ports that were critical to the resupply of their armies in Albania. It was a humiliating defeat by a partially trained, ill-equipped Greek army that emboldened Churchill to offer support. The Greek success was matched by Cunningham's willingness to take the war at sea to the Italians, and ships of the Mediterranean fleet conducted night bombardments of the Italian-held Adriatic ports.